Hey guys, welcome to the first installment of this wine study series of videos. In each episode, we'll delve into different aspects of the wine world and hopefully learn many things along the way. In this series, we'll look at how wine is made, different reds, whites, and sparkling wines from all around the world, and learn a few things everyone should know about tasting wine and being able to pair it with food. I'll be alternating this series with my regular videos, so you'll still get the cocktail videos you know and love. In this episode, we'll talk about how grapes grow and how wine is actually made. So like every good wine lesson should, first we start at the vineyard. When we're talking about vineyards, we want to be familiar with the word viticulture. Viticulture refers to the applied practices and technologies of growing grapes in the vineyard. Just about all the wines in the world are produced from the vine species Vitis vinifera, like Chardonnay or Pinot Noir, and these are the actual names of the grapes. Historically, grapevines were planted where the terrain was actually too poor to permit other crops to be grown. Ironically, it is poor soil in which the vine has to struggle that often produces the best wine. As you might guess, climate is very important when it comes to grape growing. Sunshine, relative heat and cold, and rainfall all directly affect the ripening of grapes. Vitis vinifera can grow in very different climates, but the vine needs a minimum of 50 degrees Fahrenheit or 10 degrees Celsius to grow successfully. Wines from cool climates are usually lower in alcohol and lighter in body than wines from warmer growing regions. Cool climate wine regions are normally closely identified with white and sparkling wines, while warmer regions are best known for reds. Pinot Noir is one of a handful of red grapes that actually thrive in cooler climates. Grape growing regions with quite hot or quite cool temperatures tend to be close to water. Rivers, lakes, and oceans moderate the extreme temperatures in the vineyard. Now there are several factors that determine what makes a vineyard great and another merely mediocre. And a word that gets thrown around a lot when talking about wine is terroir. The combination of climate, soil, exposure to the sun, the human factor, the care taken by growers in the vineyard, is described as terroir, a French word that links all the conditions under which the vine grows. As with anything worthwhile, there are many challenges that grape growers have to deal with. Growers face challenges including plant diseases, assorted viruses and mildews for example, and serious damage from insects. One of them is phylloxera, which is an insect louse that has attacked the vineyards of most wine growing regions, destroying entire vineyards and wine regions in its path. The method most often used to fight phylloxera is to graft Vitis vinifera vines onto various American rootstocks, which are phylloxera resistant. Another option is to plant hybrids, which are a genetic cross of Vitis vinifera and native vines. These hybrids, Saval Blanc or Baco Noir are two examples, are genetically engineered to resist phylloxera, plant diseases, and damage due to extreme climate. And lastly, the most major problem, especially in California vineyards, is Pierce's disease. Pierce's disease is caused by a bacterium and carried by an insect, a leafhopper called the glass-winged sharpshooter. The insect eats the leaves of an infected vine and carries the bacterium over to the next vine. This insect thrives in warm climates and moist soils. Pierce's disease is a very serious problem and can wipe out entire vineyards. But enough about that, let's move on to something a little sweeter, shall we? As harvest approaches, the grower and or winemaker must constantly measure the amount of sugar in the grape juice, or grape must. Sugar content represents potential alcohol in the finished wine. Now in North America, the Brix scale is used to measure the ratio of sugar to water in the grape must. The ratio of Brix to potential alcohol in the wine is roughly 1.65 to 1. For example, 23 Brix will make a dry wine of about 13 to 13.5% alcohol. Simply put, viniculture is the science and practice of making wine. Now it's very important that we understand what fermentation means. Fermentation is the conversion of sugar by yeast to ethyl alcohol. Carbon dioxide and heat are also produced during the process, but are released into the air. Selecting the appropriate yeast, natural, proprietary, or commercial, allows the winemaker to affect the flavor and body of the wine. Yeast needs oxygen to ferment the sugar in the grape must, and yeast also can't survive in extreme temperatures, hot or cold. Yeast will die at about 15.5% alcohol because the yeast will literally not be able to absorb any more sugar. Now there are basically four ways to stop fermentation. Number one, like I just mentioned, is if the fermenting must reaches about 15.5% alcohol and the yeast cannot absorb any more sugar. Number two, the fermenting must turns all of its sugars into alcohol, producing a dry wine. Therefore, there are no more sugars to feed the yeast and fermenting stops. For example, grape must with a total sugar concentration of 20 Brix will create a dry wine of about 11% alcohol. Number three, the winemaker intercedes by chilling the must, usually done in a stainless steel tank surrounded by a refrigerated jacket. When the fermenting must reaches about 20 degrees Fahrenheit, fermentation stops, and the yeast and the solids left in the must are quickly removed by centrifuge, or more slowly by passive sterile filtration. Number four, the winemaker intercedes by adding a high alcohol grape spirit, such as brandy, to the fermenting must. The fermentation of the base wine stops as the addition of the spirit puts the alcohol level at over 15.5%. Makes sense, right? This process is used to make fortified wines, such as sherry, which is mostly dry, and port, which is almost always sweet. Now, fermentation will continue until the yeast in the fermenting must have consumed all the sugar, consequently making the wine dry. If there's residual sugar in the wine after fermentation, the wine may be semi-dry or sweet, depending on how much residual sugar is in the finished wine. One way to produce sweetness in wines fermented in stainless steel tanks is to actually chill down the tanks, that way the yeast can't convert all the sugar into alcohol. A wine of very low alcohol, let's say less than 10%, and some sweetness may be produced this way. So now that we know what fermentation is, let's talk about some of the different kinds that there are. Wines that are fermented and aged in stainless steel tend to be lighter in flavor and texture than wines fermented in oak barrels. Barrels are charred or toasted. New oak barrels with a heavy toast will impart more wood tannins than older oak barrels with a lighter toast. Tannins are those compounds that create a drying, astringent sensation in the mouth. Winemakers choose French oak from specific forests or even American oaks for their barrels. American oak tends to produce a wine with a more pronounced spiciness in the flavor. Where legally permitted, chaptalization is the addition of sugar to grape must in order to increase alcohol, not sweetness. Enrichment is the addition of grape must or concentrated grape must in order to raise alcohol levels. Acidification, as you might guess, is the addition of acids to wine. Tartaric, citric, malic, and lactic are the four acids found in wine. Wines that are high in acid refresh the palate and promote saliva production, encouraging appetite for both the wine and its food accompaniments. An example of a high acid white is Sauvignon Blanc, and Pinot Noir is an example of a high acid red. Before finishing, we have to think about clarifying, fining, and filtering the wine. To clarify a wine, it is racked, which simply means it's transferred from one barrel to the next and then fined. To fine a wine, a colloidal agent such as egg whites is used to force all the suspended solids to the bottom of the tank. And to filter a wine, it is forced through a porous medium to remove any suspended solids. Some producers choose not to filter or minimally filter their wines, as they feel that filtering strips the wine of subtle flavors and negatively impacts the overall character. And lastly, we come to blending. A finished wine may be a blend of different grape types, vineyards, regions, and/or vintages, which represents the year of harvest. In most cases, if more than one grape type is used, a Cabernet Sauvignon Merlot blend, for example, finished wines from each grape type are blended together. A rare exception to this rule is field blending, in which the juice of the different varietals actually ferment together. Most still wines designate a vintage date on the label, while most, but definitely not all, sparkling wines are not vintage dated. That was a lot of information. Thank you so much for watching. I know that was a lot to process. If you want, you can click add to favorites below if you want to watch this video again later. Also, I don't know if you guys know this, but in every single video of mine, there are a couple links down below that allow you to share these videos on your Facebook or your Twitter. So you can send these videos to your friends who are interested in learning a thing or two about wine. Next video we'll be talking about white wines, so make sure you hit that subscribe button so you'll be notified when it comes out. Once again, thanks for watching, and I'll see you next time. The Fizz is a whole family of drinks that was a spin-off of the Sour, which we talked about in an earlier episode. And it was made possible by the appearance of charged water. You see, bottled water was not widely available and was very expensive in the middle of the 19th century.